The movement of people has been something familiar to quite a few formerly enslaved people of the Choctaw and Chickasaw nations. When they first came to Indian territory with their enslavers, leaving African tears upon the same trail, that meant they too would leave loved ones in their ancestral homes, never to be seen again. Among the hundreds, if not thousands, of souls that claimed Indian territory as their new home was Richmond Love and his wife, Hannah. Richmond was born in Mississippi about 1835 and would have been a mere child on that road, possibly with his father, Dick, and mother, Anne. It's not clear if his parents made the journey with him, and we don't know if his last enslaver, Sam Love, was the individual who brought young Richmond to Indian Territory. But fortunately for us, his story did not end before he could have his name and some of his story preserved in the records of the Dawes Commission. Hannah Love, Richmond's wife, has a similar story of leaving the home of her birth in Kentucky to find herself enslaved by the same Chickasaw Indian named Sam Love. Her story is interesting from the aspect that her mother, Easter, was enslaved by a man known as Captain Alberson, also a recognized Chickasaw Indian. What makes her story a bit more interesting is because she was born in Kentucky. We don't know exactly how she and her mother became the property of Captain Alberson or Sam Love. However, there is a possibility they were purchased by someone in the Love family around the time young Sam was attending the Choctaw Academy in Kentucky between the years 1835 through 1838. For Richmond and Hannah, they experience the emotional trauma that comes with the upheaval and relocation from your home and everyone you know during their personal trail of tears from Mississippi and Kentucky at such an early age. But again, we know they are survivors, and their story did not end before they could have it documented for generations of their descendants to discover. One of the earliest records that documented the lives of Richmond and Hannah Love is contained in the 1890 Chickasaw Freedmen Census. They were described as Indian Negroes at the time, living in an area known as Wynnewood Indian Territory. It was an area that had a sizable freedmen population, and when they applied for citizenship in the Chickasaw Nation 6 years later, many of the people that filed affidavits on their behalf came from this community. It must have been gratifying for both Richmond and Hannah that they were able to be within a community of freedmen that allowed them to provide for their family following their emancipation in 1866. And when they needed support in their pursuit of citizenship in the Chickasaw Nation, their friends and neighbors rallied to their side and offered their support in the testimony preserved in the 1896 applications for citizenship in the Chickasaw Nation. Richmond is supported by the statements of three people that lived in his community of Wynnewood. Joe Smith was a friend and neighbor that lived nearby. Another individual that provided an affidavit for the application of Richmond and Hannah was Zach Allen, who is enumerated on Dawes Land Allotment Card number 223. Joe Smith and Zach Allen offer similar statements about their knowledge of Richmond and Hannah. They swear in their affidavits that they had known Richmond and Hannah Love for many years, that they were enslaved by Samuel Love, a Chickasaw Indian by blood, and both were freed by Samuel Love. It is the third person that testifies on their behalf that is most interesting. Her name was Henrietta L. Jennings, a Chickasaw by blood citizen who testifies that Richmond and Hannah were slaves and held by Samuel Love, a Chickasaw Indian by blood who is now deceased. Henrietta goes on to state that Richmond and Hannah reside in the Chickasaw Nation and have resided there ever since the War of 1861. And with the Treaty of 1866, they were then free to establish ties to individuals they probably knew since the day they walked along the Trail of Tears from Mississippi in Kentucky to Indian Territory, but changes to their life and lifestyle were underway. In the year of 1898 brought with it the Dawes Commission and land allotments. It is from the information contained in the Dawes interview that we learned Richmond and Hannah had two children named Lucy and Lawrence, who are now adults rearing families of their own in the same community of Wynnewood. Lawrence was about the age of 40 when he enrolled his family with his wife Ella as Chickasaw freedmen so they all could receive 40-acre allotments. What can only be described as the pride Lawrence had in his heritage, he would name one of his sons after his father Richmond. He also demonstrated the affection he held for his sister when he named one of his daughters Lucy Ann. It would appear this family and this community was close-knit, and with the possibility of owning and controlling over 250 acres of land, Wynnewood and the surrounding area was a place that Richmond and Hannah should have felt comfortable to raise their family and nurture their grandchildren with stories of their long journeys from Mississippi and Kentucky. Their daughter Lucy, now a McKinney, is the eldest child of Richmond and Hannah. She enrolled her family of 10 as Chickasaw freedmen, but prior to that, she too had an application for citizenship as early as 1896. Not only did the same three people that provided affidavits for citizenship of her parents do the same for her, Lucy was able to have six other individuals testify on her behalf for citizenship, including two of her daughters, Zilphia Walker and Mary Jane Washington. When looking at the 1896 application for citizenship and the 1890 Chickasaw Freedmen Census, it is revealing how close-knit the community of Wynnewood was for the formerly enslaved of the Chickasaw Nation. It is particularly interesting to note the prominent leaders in that community. Names like Blue, Franklin, Harper, and Frazier are notable, and at least two stand out as people all freedmen researchers should become familiar with. Fletcher Frazier was one of the leaders that was a member of the Chickasaw and Choctaw Council that in July of 1868 submitted a memorial to Congress on the rights of the freedmen under the third article of the treaty with the Choctaw and Chickasaw Nations concluded on April 28, 1866. At the heart of this memorial was a prayerful request by the Freedmen Council of more than 40 men, and I quote, that we be removed from the Choctaw and Chickasaw Nations, close quote, because neither nation had passed legislation to adopt their formerly enslaved population. People like Richmond and Hannah Love, with their children Lawrence and Lucy, began to entertain the thought of leaving their homes in the Chickasaw Nations and the friends they knew in Wynnewood. One of the individuals to sign this memorial was named Fletcher Frazier, who was a Chickasaw by blood and the secretary of the Council of Freedmen. He was also married to a freed woman named Sookie Frazier. The efforts of the council and their memorial to Congress were not met with much success. The Chickasaw Nation in 1873 passed legislation to adopt their former slaves according to the Treaty of 1866. But because Congress failed to act immediately to ratify it, the Chickasaw legislature rethought that legislation and feared the large number of former slaves would equal their population of citizens by blood and intermarried whites, and therefore rescinded the legislation. Over the next 30 years, Richmond and Hannah Love nurtured their family as their children, Lawrence and Lucy, also began families of their own. They all enrolled themselves and their children as Chickasaw freedmen and applied and received their 40 acres of land. With Oklahoma statehood approaching and the community of Wynnewood evolving. Richmond and Hannah Love, as well as their descendants, were soon to become citizens of the United States. Wynnewood would become populated by natives, whites, freedmen, and former slaves from the United States. Wynnewood and the surrounding area began to change. The politics of race and violence in the form of lynching was front page news, and Richmond Love, the patriarch of this family, would die sometime between 1910 and 1916. From as early as 1909, there were efforts to get freedmen from the Indian Territory to immigrate to Liberia. For Hannah Love and some of her descendants, it must have seemed to be the right thing to do. Their decision to leave the place they called home for several decades, the home they saw and received the promise of 40 acres for every man, woman, and child, could not convince them Wynnewood was a safe place to live, and so they decided to leave. There was no government assistance like the first removal they were forced to endure 50 or 60 years earlier, when they were torn from their homes in Mississippi and Kentucky. Now this was their decision to pack up and take their children and grandchildren to a land in Africa that held the hopes and aspirations of displaced people who said they had had enough. It is impossible to know what made the Love family uproot their lives to go thousands of miles across the world. Was it the mob violence written about in the newspapers of black men being lynched on charges that were never proven in court? Was it the fear that one of their sons would meet the same fate of no legal protection in the new state of Oklahoma? As freedmen, they had already experienced the lack of the United States government to enforce their rights contained in the Treaty of 1866. And when the Chickasaw legislature reneged on adopting them in 1873, perhaps they should have given serious thought to removing themselves. Perhaps their decision to leave was for more altruistic reasons. Liberia was in need of people who could farm and educate the growing population there. Though Hannah was an elderly woman, her children and grandchildren would be safe from the violence that was in Wynnewood, Pauls Valley, and other nearby communities where they established their homes and friendships. Liberia was established in 1847, and for much of the time feared they would be taken over by the British, French, or Germans. Not unlike the efforts to break up Indian territory, the United States had a hand in the development of the colony of emancipated American Negroes. As we saw with the complete abdication of its fiduciary responsibilities to the protection and welfare of the emancipated slaves of the five slave-holding tribes, the United States proved to be just as detrimental to the growth of that land on the upper Guinea coast of Africa, known as Liberia. In an article in the Ardmore Statesman on March the 5th, 1910, the report of an investigation about the Liberian people, land, and government was published, and it was not a flattering view. Despite Liberia being rich in resources, not unlike Indian Territory, with magnificent forests, soil that was marvelously fertile, and the coffee and cocoa grown of the most superior quality, the United States did not want to assume another white man's burden, because members of the Foreign Affairs Committee determined they had already assumed a sufficient amount of benevolent responsibility in the Philippines, Cuba, and Santo Domingo, and that philanthropic efforts should be limited to our own hemisphere, leaving England, Germany, and France to look after the civilization of Africa. Remarkably, none of this deterred Hannah and her family members that left the United States on July 6, 1916, and we find them in Havana, Cuba, on August 22, 1916, seeking to continue their journey from the Canary Islands to their final destination of Liberia. Hannah arrived in Cuba with daughter Lucy McKinney, and now going by the name of Lucy Smith. With Lucy was her young daughter Cora, as well as her son Walter Smith, his wife Lanzetta, and their sons Roosevelt and Ernest. Lucy's other son, Abe, was with them, and he was traveling with his wife, Addie. Hannah was now without her beloved husband, Richmond. She would leave behind her son, Lawrence, and the friends she had traveled life with from Kentucky to Indian Territory. But this was her decision to leave all of that behind for a land that held the promise of a better day. The strength of this woman and her family cannot be measured or underestimated by us today, for her decision to leave Wynnewood, her friends, and some family took a great deal of courage. So she is to be saluted for that courage. There is no evidence that Hannah, Lucy, or their descendants actually made it to the shores and soil of Liberia. There is no evidence that they ever returned. For the descendants who remained, hopefully they will undertake the task of finding out what happened to these families. But know this, their story is our story, and we are all better for knowing Richmond and Hannah Love.